Hey everybody, welcome back to Northernlion Plays The Binding of Isaac. Great run, last run. What can I say? It would be... Curse of the Labyrinth. Well, to be honest with you, we were due for a Curse of the Labyrinth run, but it would be disingenuous of me to say that last run was anything but amazing, but I'm excited for hopefully even better things this time. What is he talking about, Northernlion? That was really supposed to work out better for us than it did. What do you mean, even better than a guppy run? That's just greedy. Well, I hate to say it, because I know some people are gonna be ornery about it. Must be something wrong with his medulla oblongata. Sorry, I picked the wrong quote. Mama says alligators are ornery because they got all them teeth, but they don't have no toothbrush. Well, class, Mama's wrong again. I think I'm gonna accept Mom's eye here, but yeah, even though it's gonna annoy some people somewhat, I would love to have a brimstone or Mom's knife run. Typically, the way the balance of these runs goes is if you split the runs into five, there's like five different kind of categories, I think, that end up happening in Isaac. There's your guppy runs. Now, that's, I'm discounting the fact that a lot of guppy runs only come together late. You know, you're not always overpowered from the beginning, but you know, 20% guppy runs. 60%, oh, I'm totally gonna take this. Fairly normal-ish, deal with the devil, occasionally deal with the angel-y type runs, where you don't get crazy powerful, but usually you pull something out of it. And then another 20% Mom's Knife Brimstone, and this is discounting, of course, the fact that there are some runs that just never get there. So maybe you'd actually split it up into, like, seven, and you'd say, like, 1/7 Guppy, 2/7 Mom's Knife Brimstone, then, like, 2/7 Deal with the Devil or Angel Half-Decentness, and then 1/7, hope my math is correct here, 1/7, like, no hope whatsoever. Which does happen fairly frequently. I'm super stoked to have a golden chest, or a golden key, on this floor, by the way. And as far as, like, XL floors go, this is pretty much your ideal XL floor. We got decent items in both of our shops, even though Mom's eye is not that good. I take it anyway, just because it occasionally can help us kill some enemies. It's almost like a bit of a compromised version of Abel, which is pretty bad. But that's okay. You know what? I'm gonna use the Joker card right away. So we're gonna be fighting Krampus, which means our deal with the devil on this floor sucks, the big one. But at least we figured it out early, I guess. And hopefully we have a better chance at hitting a deal with the devil next time. We're probably gonna get a deal with the devil anyway. In fact, that, I mean, now it looks pretty obvious that I should have saved this Joker card for later, right? Now I'm the idiot because I didn't do that. However, My thinking was, why don't we use it now, and then we'll take something, and then we'll reroll the other thing if it's not that good, and then we'll have another reroll to use on it later. And if it had worked out like that, no one would have been the wiser. Except now we find ourselves in a position where we're just gonna end up probably gaining access to a freaking empty... That was dumb. Gaining access to an empty room after we pick up Lump of Coal. The flip side is we are gonna get Lump of Coal early, and if something goes terribly wrong, at least we got guaranteed access to our deal with the devil. Now I can totally afford to go to our curse room because, yeah, it's not like there's anything stopping us. We actually gained spirit hearts on it anyway, but yeah, that was fine. Annoying, but fine. Now I wish I hadn't spent that bomb because that red chest is extremely tempting for me. I guess I can't really complain too much. I was just talking about how this is like your ideal XL floor. Why? Well, in the first room we got spirit hearts and we got a golden key. What are your normal concerns on your first XL floor? I don't want to lose all of my chances at a deal with the devil just by taking damage immediately, so I want spirit hearts. Oh, by the way, it would be really nice if I could actually open up some doors. Here's a golden key. Speaking of which, we should definitely try to find a way to access this golden chest. Just give me some bombs. We've got to be getting pretty close to the end of this. The end of this floor, I mean. But it's absolutely completely feasible that one bomb could be the seam that we need here. Ooh. Careful. Yeah, you know, we open a golden chest with one bomb, and then it gives us, like, three bombs back, and then we get more bombs, and then, you know, bombs are the word, man. Larry Jr. does not bomb through me at all. I'm probably standing a little bit too close to the dragon's mouth here. That's an expression that I just made up that sounds like it could plausibly have existed at some point in the world. I mean, Sisko's album, Enter the Dragon, I mean, of course, that's a reference to that old, euphemism, isn't it? Too close to the dragon's mouth. Means your food's too spicy. I was really hoping that this would not be a range upgrade, but hey, we're not, worried about our rerolls, so we might as well reroll it right away. And that turns into meat, which, by my calculations, it's about 2,000 or 3,000 times better. So I'd say that was a pretty good reroll for us. So from a, you know, killing power perspective, we're in a really, really good position right now. Lump of coal gives us some extra damage. Oh, you should have taken lump of coal, or you should have taken the range upgrade because you picked up lump of coal. No. Well, typically, my philosophy on range upgrades is that you get enough of them by accident, that you don't need to worry about forcing yourself to take them through other means. I'm not happy with where we're at right now. I mean, I'm happy with this run so far. I'm not happy with the fact that we don't have any bombs. But there is a small chance. This is a risk-free operation here. There's a small chance that we can get into the shop for free, because we have a golden key. Buy a bomb for 3 cents. Open that golden chest for free. Get enough bombs to access all the other stuff. That would be easy peasy lemon squeezy if it works out. Okay. I sincerely doubt we'll be able to get to the 15 cents necessary to actually, There should be a golden bomb, by the way, that for one floor just lets you use bombs as much as you want. That would be cool as heck. Anyway, Yes, let's hope this works out. There's no guarantee that it works out, but I think for 3 cents, it's a reasonable gamble. 3 cents to open a golden chest is a pretty good deal in my book. I'm gonna have to take damage here because I bunged this up again, unless I can... Oh, jeez. Got my Jerry Lundegaard impression on, but hey, we got a second golden key. If you get 2 golden keys, that should count as, you know, 1 regular key. The second one should anyway, but whatever, can't really complain. Down to the next floor. Great defense, great offense, good HP. We'll trade that HP away later, hopefully. Another Curse of the Labyrinth. You know, the ultimate good but bad situation here. We have the keys necessary to open more or less what we need to open. I don't know what our deal with the devil chances are going to look like here. At least we're on the caves instead of the catacombs. I don't know, maybe this is a godsend. I have no freaking idea, to be honest with you. Let's get out of the way of that. Alright, this golden chest should be easy. I could make good use of small rock right now. That's alright. 2 spirit hearts is also a really good payout, especially considering we got it for the price of free. Now, with lump of coal, you probably don't want to just like stand right next to the turret to do damage. But that's what I'm going to do. And if we could actually land some shots like behind us with Mom's Eye, that would be amazing, but... Either way, I'm content with our current situation, but this is going to be a definitive floor. If we're not strong, I mean, we're strong right now, but if we're not proportionally stronger by the time we finish this floor, that could be, you know, the canary in the coal mines for us kind of losing pace, because we're losing, at this point, we've lost 2 shops. Our first shop, we missed out on the map, but we bought a bomb in the process. Our second shop, you know, is gone to the ether just as a result of the fact that, we're on an XL floor, so we've already missed out on pretty much like 50% of our shop capacity. It's not really 50%, but it depends how much money we get on this floor. I'm kind of exaggerating, and also my brain feels a little bit melty right now. But, oh, the bomb, or the boss is right here. As long as we can get like a deal with the devil on this floor, I'll feel very good about things. And even if things go pretty poorly, ooh, that was pretty dangerous. Even if things go pretty poorly, I think it'll be hard for me to leave this floor without at least a small, you know, overall positive impression, because our first XL floor was so good for us. But I would love to kind of like leverage our existing advantages to get disproportionately strong by the time we get down to the next floor, which again could be Necropolis, which is why I'm a little bit paranoid about getting super strong, because the game gets super strong very, very unpredictably sometimes. Now, hold on to your hats. It's gonna be a long Gertie Jr. fight here. Longer than your average baseball game. Baseball catches a lot of shit, man. And I've been guilty of it in the past. You know, what's the stereotype of baseball? It's boring. You know, games take 2.5, 3 hours. There's 162 goddamn games in a season. That's absurd. You follow the NBA? 80 games. NHL? 82 games. 162 games is staggering. You know, in Barclays Premier League, isn't it like 30 games or 38 games or something like that? Matches, I guess. Sorry, I didn't want to use the unregal dialect there. So following baseball is like a lot of very, very long afternoons. But the older I get, and the more... I'm gonna take this, by the way. No nickel, but that's okay. The more invested in, like, stats I get, like, the more I get titillated by numbers, and I'm slowly getting there, the more the idea of baseball kind of intrigues me, but I'm not quite there yet. I'm not trying to say, by the way, that if you're young and you enjoy watching baseball and following the baseball season, you're, like, old beyond your years or something like that. I'm finally starting to get it. I think one of the challenges that's always been there for me, and I played a lot of baseball when I was younger, like, a lot of baseball, instead of soccer. You know, you normally play soccer, baseball, and or hockey. I played baseball. So I know the sport inside and out, more or less. I played MLB The Show this year, and I like it. But one of the challenges for, like, a spectator purpose in baseball is that there's only, like, three kinds of baseball highlights that you see on a regular basis. Let's check out our boss room here first. I'm not going to pick up either of these. I'll pick up the pact now. So, yeah. You know, if you're watching SportsCenter... That's with an RE in Canada, not an ER. And there's a basketball highlight. Typically, it's like LeBron James drives to the key and it's the greatest slam dunk of all freaking time, right? Or, you know, a three-pointer or something like that. Oh, careful. If you see a football highlight, it's, you know, Tom Brady steps back, launches like an 80-yard pass, and then somebody catches it with one hand out and like barely tucks into a roll to get the touchdown. And they do a funny little dance afterwards. In hockey, you know, Alexander Ovechkin comes up, falls on his butt, and then, you know, twirls the stick above his head and scores a goal. These are all exciting, potentially exciting highlights. Every highlight in baseball fits, like, one of three things. It's either, you know, Albert Pujols steps up to the plate. And it's a home run for Albert Pujols, his 43rd of the season, right? So there's that. It gets a little samey. Or it's, you know... Hideki Matsui on the plate, throws a fastball, and he got him. That's the inning. I'm gonna take this pill right away. I'm glad I did. Like I said, accidental range upgrades are the only range upgrades you need. And the other one is like, somebody's in the outfield. Dated myself, I wanted to say Nomar Garcia-Para, who I don't even think is an outfielder, but anyway. Daryl Strawberry, back to the wall, and he catches it. I think that makes it hard to kind of like, For baseball to kind of transmit itself culturally, because why do you want to watch basketball? The dope-ass slam dunks? Yeah, no problem. Why do you want to watch hockey? You seen what freaking Sidney Crosby can do? I'm so excited to have Quad Shot here. Why do you want to watch baseball? Well, on an intellectual level, it titillates me, and I think it's the dedication of long-term commitment to a you know? But I'm starting to get that, I think, as I get older. I'm starting to get into those decimal points and the Corsis and the OBPSs and stuff like that. I don't know, though. We'll see. It would help if I had a West Coast team that was closer than, you know, the Mariners. Because you might say, oh, well, you've got a team that's way closer, and the Mariners, they're only like a couple hours away. Or you could cheer for the Blue Jays, which are Canadian. But yeah, they're from a different country, man. Easier said than done. How can I cheer for Seattle when Toronto's in the league? I've got more of an allegiance to my countrymen, I suppose, even though it's based on dated kind of, you know, 48th parallel type stuff. I don't know what I'm even talking about. It's a ramble. It's a late Isaac episode. It's like 9 p.m. Keep your speakers on low. Don't want mom and dad to wake up. I've been playing a lot of Counter-Strike Global Offensive lately. I'll allow that. I've been playing a lot of Global Offensive lately, and I love the game, and I love the passion of the community. This is me at like a job interview now. I love your passion, but the people that talk in that game, and you have to talk because you have to communicate, otherwise you're guaranteed to lose. If you talk, at least there's a chance you won't lose. Anyway, the people that talk are the angriest people on the internet. You know, you meet them for the first time, and I've gotten used to it now because it's been going on in Counter-Strike for so long. I've been playing it for so long. There is no, hey, good luck, have fun. At least I'm, for people wondering, I'm Gold Nova 1 now. So I'm probably like low intermediate, and that's tooting my own horn a little bit. You might consider it high beginner. Still a lot to learn. Anyway, and that took me like 200 hours to get there, but there's no like, hey, you know, we're both enjoying the same game here. We have some common ground. Good luck, have fun. Let's have a clean game out there, folks. As soon as you join the game, it's just, you know, homophobia, racial slurs all the time, and then, you know, good lunch, have fuck you, basically. No one says have a good game. But what really gets me is, and this is tying into the late night thing here, but I know, by the way, that that's just the internet. You know, this isn't my first day on the internet. I'm just saying, sometimes I just want to sign on and, you know... I come from the competitive chess sphere to some extent, where, you know, you could be like a 50-year-old doctor, and a 12-year-old just comes in and beats the shit out of you, and you shake his hand and you say, good game, even though you want to say, you know, I fucked your grandma last night or something like that. So, you know, you gotta keep those animal instincts on under control, but I guess the anonymity of the internet allows that to shine. But anyway, I'll be playing games at like 11 p.m. Pacific time on a Tuesday, because I'm an adult and I make my own hours, and I can do that if I want to. And I'll be playing, and then I'll die, and some kid will get on, but he'll be, maybe not kid, you know, maybe like 18, 17. I'm not trying to say that all 18 and 17-year-olds are like this, or that I wasn't like this when I was 18 and 17, because I totally was. But anyway, they'd get on and they whisper, because, you know, mom and dad are asleep, oh my god, you fucking idiot, how could you fucking do that? And I'm like, why don't you pay rent, bitch? I pay taxes that put you in school right now. Don't call me a fucking idiot, okay? Let's just be civil here. Let's have a good time with one another. I apologize for my own colorful language here, by the way, but it always makes me laugh and shake my head. This is the only game, and I played a lot of Dota. I played like 800, 900 hours of Dota, right? People always talk about MOBA communities as being really toxic. That's the word. The MOBA community is so toxic. People are so toxic to one another. And you're not wrong. In the MOBA community, people will turn on you in a heartbeat. And it won't be like, hey, where'd you go? Like, you were gone for 12 minutes? That's pretty effed up, dude. I hate you. It's more like, excuse me, you didn't buy Ironwood branches at the start of the game? You're an idiot. I hate you. We're gonna lose. GG, this guy's an idiot. Like, you know, frogs falling from the sky. Stuff like that. But Counter-Strike is the only game I played in my entire life, and it's a great game. But it's the only game I played in my entire life where after playing it for like 2 hours, I actually feel like I need to go, like, talk to people in real life. Because it can easily make you think that the world is going to hell in a handbasket, because the only way that people ever talk to each other in Counter-Strike is to either chide someone for their mistakes. Occasionally you'll have somebody who says, nice try. But what they really mean is, I wouldn't have died if I was in that situation, but I'm going to be polite about it. And I respect that. I appreciate that. But there's like three different kinds of communication in Counter-Strike. One is, you're a fucking idiot. You're dumb. You're bad. Stop playing the game. That's probably like 50% of the communication in Counter-Strike. 25% of the remaining half is blasting either... Seriously, I can't believe we didn't get anything more amazing out of this, but we'll try these pills. Tears up, range up, that's good. Tears up, range up. Tears down for your life. Wow, okay, kind of a mixed bag there. We're gonna be leaving this floor, obviously. So 25% soundboards or songs. Played through the microphone at full blast. Typically, some kind of K-pop song, which is really weird for me as someone who lived in Korea for a time and is now watching this kind of like K-pop wave splash over the population. I'm not passing any judgment one way or the other. There's a lot of very catchy K-pop songs. It's just surprising to me because when I originally went to Korea, even though it was only a few years ago, it was not like that. I guess it was, you know, G and Bubble Pop and Gangnam Style pushed it over the threshold. By the way, I apologize for not talking more about Isaac, but A, people always message me and say, hey, love the tangents. No one ever says, hey, I really like that part where you talked about, you know, the deal with the devil meta for the 30th time. So I'm playing to my strengths here, I hope. The other 25% is just like, I don't even know how to describe it. I would maybe just noise. Like, there's deliberately angry comments. There's deliberately a kind of like, you know, I don't know what you'd say, like prankish kind of stuff, like playing the K-pop through your speakers all the time. And then there's just noise sometimes. Like 25% of the communication in Counter-Strike is just somebody in their microphone going like over and over. And not even like for any purpose. And I don't get it, but if you play it long enough, first off, it starts to have an impact on you. Like, I find myself becoming more aggressive the more Counter-Strike I play online. I don't call anybody out on their mistakes, but I, you know, instead of just living and let live, if somebody calls me out, I start to be like, what the, oh my god, I'm second fragging on the team right now and you're gonna give me shit, you're 3-11, blah blah. Anyway, turns me into a monster. But also, it makes you question the state of the world today, And it takes, you gotta step back and get some perspective, right? And this goes for anybody playing online games. I think it's very easy to get cynical about humankind. And I've long been an optimist in my life. And I mean that sincerely, despite the fact that I complain about a lot of things. Most of it is self-aware complaining. And almost all of my complaining about the way, pardon me, that people act is couched in self-awareness to the point where almost all of my jokes about along those lines, my intention with them is to say, aren't I an asshole for thinking people are assholes for doing this? It's almost like, it's not a character because it's legitimate, but it's me saying, I'm kind of being a dick, isn't this funny? It's like a Larry David type Curb Your Enthusiasm thing. But it's very easy to become cynical if you like don't get out of your house, which I often don't, and then your only interaction with other humans on a daily basis is you're an idiot because of this video game. I don't even know what I'm talking about in the course of this Isaac episode anymore. Let's get back on track. So that's my misadventures in Counter-Strike. Don't ruin your deal with the devil chances here. It's pretty unlikely I'm going to get one to begin with. That was really good. It's pretty unlikely I'm going to get one to begin with because I already have had deals with the devil, like, very, very frequently. In fact, our only two floors thus far have both given me deals with the devil, which is awesome. But it means that I guess if you're going to throw, yeah, it's fine to throw here because you probably weren't going to get one anyway. Let's try not to die in the process. I'm very glad we have Bloody Penny, by the way. And we could still get a deal with the devil in this situation, but we'll save this judgment card. We'll slow play it. Really hope we get an arcade on the next floor, but who are we fighting? It's going to be Monstro 2. Very easy, and even though we only have 5 HP here, this is an extremely good template for a run. I'm kind of, because I was on that tangent for so long, I'm kind of rediscovering this run myself. Lump of Coal, Quad Shot. Yeah, we're in a good spot. Those are the only items that we really need to talk about right now. We did get a deal with the devil. We'll take the mark. I think we took the pact earlier, so we'll take the mark. I think we'll reroll that, and we're not going to pick the... Oi! Okay, maybe I'm not an idiot. Maybe. Temporarily, I was like, I'm a big dummy because I didn't use the judgment card in there. But 7 cents might not be enough to secure a payout from judgment. So maybe I'm not the idiot that I believe in my heart that I am right now. That was a sloppy play, though. I should have done that, but it's possible that this is the right decision by accident. And that's okay. That's okay. We might still get a chance to walk back in there, although I doubt it. If we do, I'll go for it. We got the 1-up as well, which is nice, especially the more HP we get. Just kind of a fail-safe in case things go terribly, terribly wrong. In our item room, we got 10 extra bombs, which means for sure I'm going to go back to that one room and trade a bomb for 2 cents, because again, this is the whole, you know, if we get to use this judgment card thing, I'd like to. We could also just use judgment on the curse room, but I'd really like to save our money. Oh, that's good. I'd really like to save our money right now to give us a better chance of spawning an arcade on the next floor, considering we have Bloody Penny. It's a 6-9 right there. You see that? I rarely notice that. We're stuck with our speed upgrade. That's okay. I can live with it. Yeah, I might have botched it a little bit, but we also picked up the mark, which is sweet. And we're 1/3 of the way to becoming Guppy. And we did spawn an arcade, so now, you know, the world's our burrito. What do you mean the world's arboretum? The world is a building made of trees? That's not really what an arboretum is. That's okay, too, though. Alright, what do we need now? What the world needs now is seriously HP. Only just for me. I had a feeling we'd be fighting greed here. Missed a great rhyming opportunity, because greed kind of rhymes with me. But we're going to reroll that anyway. And ooh, the nun's habit. That's amazing. We should be able to get a staggering amount of rerolls here if we desire them. Nun's habit, probably the best shop item in the game. Pretty stoked that we have nun's habit plus compass. Missed out on the map, but our shops ended up working out just fine, I'd say. Just fine indeed. Razorblade is straight up trashed here. We're not going to be using that for anything at all. Well, I mean, we may be in the future. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. We might be an item that we'd actually like to see show up, but that's not going to matter because it's never coming back, baby. Yeah, I had a feeling I'd take damage there. That just didn't go very well. I kind of got lost in my own head there. I thought we'd knock them out, and we didn't. This is not a floor where I would be hopeful about a deal with the devil if that was not 100% obvious. Razorblade becomes Yumheart, which with the nun's habit, how could I say no? So the first thing we'll do, it's a little bit botched, I'll admit to that readily. Because we're going to miss out on some rerolls, but we're going to miss out on rerolls for a guaranteed payout one way or the other. Whether it's the exact item we want or not, we're here for the payout, baby. I don't know where that baby's coming from. I don't like it, but I'm using it, so I'm as bad as anybody. So what's my plan here? Well, we have Nun's Habit, so pretty much, yeah, that sucks. We're just going to play the crap out of this blood bank, and we'll get unlimited money and more red hearts than we could ever possibly want. Basically, we already probably could have played this ad infinitum just thanks to Bloody Penny. But thanks to Yumheart, it's not even a question. In fact, what we should do is play one more time. Just so that we can... This is dumb. Don't do what I did. I'm going to use Yumheart here just to be safe. We can always get out of this jam later. But I did this so that we can get to our boss trap room. This is a room that should be D6'd, though. And we don't want to pick that up, so we'll come back here. It's still, like, a little risky here. Thank you for not paying out yet. So there should be more than enough red hearts back there. We can probably switch back to our D6 permanently. We don't have a reroll ready for it yet. That's all right. Let's go try our boss room on Versailles. There's a cleverer way we can do this. We can take a Yumheart full charge in. But if it's just HP in here anyway, which it is, we're not going to take damage. To the point where we're going to die. So I don't think it really matters that much. A bit sloppy play for me, I'll admit. My fundamentals aren't on. But that's what you get when you get the tangents, right? Instead of just the standard strategic commentary. Sacrifice a little bit of the min-maxy type stuff, even though I don't really min-max, the pseudo-min-maxy type stuff for the outrageous baseball tangents that pretty much make no sense, and me talking about how playing Counter-Strike has made me lose my faith a little bit in humanity, but it's a bullshit loss of faith, because it's a video game, right? You can't judge people in real life by the way that they act in a video game. I mean, we all do. You know, someone doesn't do the exact optimal thing in a game. I'm guilty of it too, as much as I rail against it when it happens to me, but we're all like, oh, that guy's a fucking idiot. He's not. He's probably just not, it might not even be a dude, but he might be just bad at the game, right? That stuff happens from time to time, aka all the time. But anyway, like I said, you know, I'm too harsh on people a little bit. But I'm harsh because they're being harsh too. The weird thing about it though is games like Counter-Strike, Dota, I think they actually are some of the most, you know, shining examples. I'm not going to pick that up, even though it could be useful. Some of the most shining examples of games that can actually teach you, like, really valuable metrics and skills and qualities. You know, they can embed in you qualities that make you a much more well-rounded person. Like, Counter-Strike. What has Counter-Strike taught me? Humility, for one. I've got so much time invested in it, and I'm still shitty. It's taught me the value of, you know, I'm going to take it. It's taught me the value of, like, practice and dedication and teamwork and communication, and always being clear with what you want, you know, giving people information that helps them succeed and stuff like that. It's done a lot for me in that regard. But the people, and there's very successful people that play it, and I think the audience for Counter-Strike is a little bit older than your audience for a lot of other games. It just amazes me that, you know, you don't, maybe you do, because I've never been a professional athlete, but I don't think you have, like, players in the NBA that just go like, hey, like Kobe Bryant, I'm LeBron James and I fucked your mom. Maybe they do, though. Maybe there's been cases of trash talkers in sports that are like, hey, you know what? Ate your wife out last night, Wayne Gretzky, and he's like, oh, come on, man. Can't we just have a clean game? I guess trash talk is a part of sports. I don't know, man. I don't know what I'm talking about anymore. Let's just be honest with it. This has been a very vulgar episode. The fact that this is not paid out yet blows my mind like an Eve song featuring Gwen Stefani. Surely, at some point, this will redeem itself, resolve itself. I mean, we have 99 cents. That's enough to buy a coat from the thrift shop, as far as I understand it. It's a staggering amount of rare. We even won the keys there. That's sweet. We'll save those keys even though we could use them to open golden chests here. Like, every single one of these pennies is paying out, almost. So we can stand here forever. But we're not getting any more money in the process. There we go, finally. You know, fine. We didn't win that one. Well, if we ever lose Red Hearts, we know where to come. Alright, so now money equals power would be the dopest. If we could get it. What am I even hoping for right now? I mean, I guess I'm hoping... Tears upgrade's pretty sweet. I guess I'm hoping that we just come across some consumables. Pills would be awesome because we already know that they'd be good because we have PhD, or at least not bad. Apart from that, nothing much really. We're looking for an easy-ish fight against Mom. If we could pick up some Spirit Hearts in the process, that would be very useful to help us get a deal with the devil on the next floor, where we're only... We're two guppy items away from becoming guppy. But probably only, you know, like a flying item away from being in a very, very, very good position. We're already in a pretty good position. Our HP is acceptable. And our damage is great. I don't know, though. I just don't know if we can make this run work. You know what would be great? The wafer. Yeah, you're right. It would be great to take like half damage for the rest of the game. Keep dreaming. Probably not gonna happen. Red version of Mom is not a concern. We're doing decent damage. The thing that worries me is that... Well, not worries me. It annoys me is that I can only really land one hit from distance. Which means that we're not really getting that much value out of Lump of Coal right now. But the fight's over, pretty much. And we haven't really had... I was just going to say we haven't really had to deal with that bullshit. Oh, well. All right. One bomb for two bombs. Pretty good trade. More HP and more HP. Probably should have stayed at a half-heart interval, but it doesn't matter too much. Alright. Most important thing here. Don't take damage. Obviously, like, 100 times easier said than done. But if we can avoid taking damage, which is plausible with the kind of run we got set up here. Get our deal with the devil. Use the judgment card there. Possibly 6 deal with the devil item pedestals. Could be enough to find 2 more guppy items. Ooh. We'll talk about that. Could be enough to find 2 more guppy items. Could be enough to find a Mom's Knife or something like that. I'm not going to shy away from Mom's Knife at this point. I haven't had Mom's Knife in like 6 runs. It's an acceptable item to pick up at that duration or that kind of refractory period. Oh, I took damage and I feel really bad about it. It's okay. It's okay. Just don't take red heart damage against the boss. All will be well. Now, don't let me forget me that we do have an Eternal Heart back there. Those are pretty valuable as far as HP goes. Here's our half-heart interval. We're gonna go to our curse room as well, so we got a lot left to do after we finish this area over here. And that's a good mini-boss. Or maybe not a good one, but it's not greed, which makes it good in my book. Pretty much exactly what I was hoping for. Work with me, buddy. Drop, like, super bandage or something. Did I just have a stroke of kind of, like, actually remembering what Super Gluttony can drop for you? He doesn't drop less than 3, does he? I've always been saying that. Does he drop Super Bandage? Oh, he dropped a Spirit Heart. That's, you know, fairly close. Alright, so here's our hopeful deal with the devil chance. This guy. I'm not a very good Christopher Walken impersonator. He's ruined my shit more times than I'd like to admit. Accidentally rhymed. Do you see that eye block all of those shots? Come on now. Just ridiculous. I got quad shot and yet still can't even land him. We're almost done with this though. Feeling real good. Oh, it worked. Okay. Deal with the devil. Work with me. Work with me. Nope. So we blew it with our whole judgment thing earlier. We're gonna take the HP for sure. If you could just pay out, that would be sweet. Maybe you could even give me the map. Like, that would make my life slightly easier. But I can wait. It's okay. Run's still great. One more key would be a little bit of peace of mind as well. Hey! Who said you can't always get what you want? Eat your heart out, Paul McCartney. Okay. That was, you can always get what you want. Say it with me now. You do always... Oh, why waste the spirit heart? Okay, disregard that. With the map, we can find the secret room. We do have the 1-up, I totally forgot. Yeah, we're in a great position right now. Map plus compass. Curse of Darkness becomes our main nemesis now. That was very, very risky. And we'll be headed down to the next floor, where we get Curse of Darkness. Had to happen. Hopefully this means we don't get it on the cathedral. Obviously, that's not what it means. I'm just trying to, you know, ignore the rules of probability and statistics. Gets you in trouble more often than not, you know? Correlation doesn't equal causation necessarily. Well, often anyway. My stats class in university was, is a rude awakening for me. Not because of, you know, what we were taught. It wasn't like it changed my worldview or anything like that. The way it was taught changed my worldview. We had to do these, like 10 assignments. Each one was worth something like 2.5%. So in total, they were worth a lot. Individually, not worth very much. Or maybe it was 5 assignments worth 10% each. I don't remember. It's a long time ago, and clearly, it has not had an incredible bearing on my life. But I remember, like, on the second assignment. First assignment is super easy. It's like the college version of write your name on this piece of paper. You know, it's difficult from the context of someone who's, you know, you couldn't just pull anybody off the street and finish it, but if you're in the program and invested in it, you can figure it out pretty easily. The second one, real challenging. Lots of figures, lots of graphs. Had something like a 3-page limit on it. So I worked my ass off on it. I eventually figured out a solution that worked for me. All sorts of, you know, Mathematica stuff to plug into it and the figures, graphs, etc., etc., as mentioned many times. Got a little bit over. It was like 5.1 pages or something like that, or 3.1 pages. It was like 0.1 page over whatever the limit was. And I submitted it, and I got like a 40. Not out of like 50, 40 out of 100. And I was like, dude, what the heck's up with this? And he's like, well, we deducted like 30% because you were over the page limit. It was like you were one page over the limit, that's 30% or something like that. And I was like, wow, that's crazy. And I tried to appeal it, and the professor was basically just like, sorry, dude. Those are the rules. And that's when I realized, fuck writing. That's not really where I wanted to go with that. But it was like, man. Well, first off, that's when I realized, there are powerful assholes. Because this guy probably thinks he's teaching me a lesson, right? And maybe he's still wiser than I am. He's certainly older. That's not even me trying to fire a shot. But I was like, dude, I learned my lesson, right? You scared the shit out of me. I'm not going to go over the page limit of the future. Just let me off with a warning. But he was like, nope, this is serious business. And I was like, that's when I realized that a lot of people are just assholes. And kind of, I mean, maybe get a little bit of pleasure out of taking it out on other people. You could argue, sure, I was in the wrong. I have no investment in this assignment anymore. It's been years. Many, many years, actually, at this point. Better part of a decade. But still, I hold a little bit of a grudge because I feel like I didn't learn anything from it except, oh, there are adult dicks. Which, you know, is a lesson that takes a little while to learn, I guess. But once you're an adult yourself, I think if you try hard to be a nice person, you have this illusion that a lot of other people do too. And it's not an illusion. A lot of people try their best to be good people. Some of them are just self-righteous and misguided. Some of them take a little bit of pleasure out of holding their power over others, and I feel like maybe that professor was guilty of it. It's a shame, because he is actually a genius. Like, internationally recognized. But kind of a cockhead as well. I can say that, because I've already got my degree. Suck on that shit. Up to the next floor. But yes, maybe I can teach you something from this lesson. Respect page limits, man. It wasn't like I was trying to use flowery language or anything like that. There were a lot of graphs. I wasn't trying to write a lot to compensate for the fact that I didn't know enough. I just should have clicked the graphs a little bit smaller, but I was like, I think I should make the graphs more readable as opposed to adhering to the page limit, and then we would have preferred if you just put it in at like a tiny minuscule to fit this arbitrary fucking restriction. Whatever, dog. Whatever helps you sleep at night. You dung muncher. Anyway. That's my story about the most important thing that I learned in university. That's not true, by the way. I don't want to be seen as as having a horse in that race. Plenty of successful people don't go to university. Plenty of successful people do go to university. I went to university. I consider myself reasonably successful. I do a job that I love every single day. That's success enough as far as I'm concerned, especially for this point in my life. But I didn't necessarily need to go to college to do what I'm doing right now. By the way, I'm not saying university to be like, oh, university. It's just, you know, in Canada, I think the terms have different connotations. University is a different thing than college here. Because we're adherents to the old, you know, colonial style of things, I guess. Yes, we still have the queen on our money. Believe it. Yeah, she's still technically our head of state. No, she is not our president. No, the queen is not our version of Barack Obama. Nope, she doesn't literally sign everything that comes into power. She has an agent in Canada called the Governor General. Pretty much just signs whatever comes across his or her desk. Thank God I have this bad trip pill. I'm getting on a Canadian misconception rant again. That's not where you want to be. But it is still Canadian Thanksgiving weekend, so it seems fitting. If not now, then when? If not now, then when? Okay. We're going to be moving along here pretty soon. I'm pretty sure that this run is won. Not to Dr. Seussify things. I think what would make me feel a lot more comfortable is if we managed to somehow get out of this floor without using our 1-up, which I think is conceivable. So I shouldn't have said somehow, because it plays up a false drama that doesn't really exist. But, ooh, that was a little dangerous there. If we can get out of this floor without using our 1-up, I think we're in a really good position. Now, if we could somehow get out of this floor without using our bad trip, that would be incredible. Like, if we got another bad trip pill or something like that, that would be insane. It would be gone. The run would be over already, if it's not already. We're not going to pick that up because we don't have the wafer. That was but a pipe dream in my head. Two orbitals, thanks to that halo of flies. You know, I'm just going to stand back here. We'll try to dodge the shots as they come in. And we're doing good damage here. That was not good. It'd be nice to stop knocking those bombs away, but with quad shot, it's kind of hard to place them in a spot where none of the shots will hit, you know? So we're going to get permanent polar invincibility in just a second here. Yeah, you know what? We're going to end up using bad trip. That's fine. Shit happens. We still have our 1-up. If we can avoid using our 1-up until the boss fight on the next floor, or like a room very close to the boss fight, that's my next goal. But we're going to have, rerolls ready, along with the Nun's Habit, which is great, for the chest, which we haven't had in a little while, at least in high, supply. Actually, I guess a couple of runs ago we did have that. I think we got mostly like middle tier items though that I just decided to roll with, so this is a slight change of pace. Oh, yes! Yes! This is sweet! I didn't pick up Book of Shadows before I rerolled it. It's a lazy habit. It's a bad habit, but that's okay. So what is awesome is that we just got an all stats upgrade, which is great, especially because all stats up also means, you know, range up, which means better damage from Lump of Coal from further away, but also Polyphemus, which just is a game winner, not by itself, but it doesn't need a lot to synergize with to really show its true potential. So I'm very stoked about those items that we got here, and this is a one run, it is. It would take an almost unfathomable crisis to put us in a dangerous situation here. We have the 1-up, so really, as long as we can just make it to the boss room, we're gonna have like 9 HP, 10 HP to deal with. Pretty solid. Celtic Cross we'll take, because we have enough HP to actually get a few periods of permanent Polaroid invincibility out of it. I think we can do this one without even having the 1-up as well. Which is not necessarily like that enormous of a coup, but you know what I mean. And now, like, our mom's eye tears are actually real freaking good. If we can hit something with them, we would do a lot of damage. Yeah, half heart, that's where we want to be. Oh, I can feel the sneeze coming in the air tonight. To be one-shotting an enemy with, we might as well go to it now. To be one-shotting an enemy, like, the last half of Famine with one Polyphemus tier is a hugely good thing. That normally does not happen, even with Polyphemus, unless you have Mom's Knife and or Brimstone. So I'm just going to stand right here, and this is basically over whether or not I get hit. So why even bother dodging? Thank you, Celtic Cross, for that period of invincibility. I appreciate it, I suppose. And this is gonna do it. Thanks for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed the episode. If you did, click the like button. It helps out a great deal. And of course, subscribe if you want to see more in the future. But for now, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.